suggesting that I start the recording. So tonight we're going to be again listening to a podcast from For Heaven's Sake. It's not the latest one. The latest one came out this morning, and although I listened to it, I felt I wanted to stay with this one on the topic of ceasefire. Just a note that I think as everyone is talking about Israeli ceasefire, and no one is talking about Hamas ceasefire. In any case, let us listen again to our friends, Danielle Hartman from the Hartman Institute, so named for his father, Zichronot Livracha, and Yossi Klein Halevi. And I'll need to see a thumbs up from all of you for when I start recording to make sure that you can hear it.
Mission Israel at war. And today is day 81.
Can you hear it?
And today we decided to discuss something that's emerging in the public discourse and which is going to challenge Israel in not simple ways. And that is the discussion around ceasefire. For much of the world, with the possible public exception of the United States administration, ceasefire now seems to be a moral imperative, not merely a practical imperative, a moral imperative, to bring to an end the death of civilians in Gaza. October 7th launched a just war, but that just war, from the perspective of much of the world, is not being fought justly. And as a result, it just has to be brought to an end. For Israelis, we're in a very, very different place. I don't think Israelis are ready for a ceasefire. Or, if they are, it's not in the same terms that are being discussed. And it puts us Israelis in a relatively complicated place. And today we want to talk about how do we as Israelis feel about something that is increasingly self-evident. Tom Friedman is speaking about it. Egypt is offering proposals. Self-evident that you need a ceasefire. Now let's just debate the conditions. And Israelis are going to have to adjust to it. And I want to talk about, Yossi, how you and I feel about it and how we feel Israelis feel about it. We're not going to get into the technical questions of what is necessarily the best ceasefire or not, but more, how does this whole world conversation meet us Israelis? So you'll see here, I don't know, you read Tom Friedman, Egypt, America. What does it do to you?
You know the wonderful Hebrew phrase, "B'toch ami ani yoshev," I sit among my people. Very complicated phrase, really. I sit among my people. I am part of the overwhelming Israeli consensus. 90% of Israeli Jews not only support the war, but want the war to continue until Hamas is toppled. And I think that there are several reasons for that. Now, I'll speak personally. When you speak about the moral imperative for much of the world of ending the war, and I think you phrased it precisely right, my perspective, and I would dare say strong majority of Israelis agree, is that the moral imperative is to bring down Hamas. And that places us at direct variance with much of world opinion. And you're right, we are going to have to start internalizing that. But I think that there's also another dimension. It's not only that it's a moral imperative to defeat evil, but if we end this war with Hamas being able to declare victory in whatever way, for me, emotionally now, it means that October 7th won. And we went to war, Daniel, to restore two elements of Israeli credibility that were shattered on October 7th. The first was our military deterrence, and the second was the Zionist promise, the covenant we made with the Jewish people to create a safe refuge for the Jewish people here. both of those promises, both of those forms of credibility were destroyed on October 7th, and we went to war to restore that. If Hamas, this genocidal regime, remains on our border, we failed.
So how do you feel, though, when you hear this conversation? I know that you want to continue the war.
I feel
and
assaulted.
And what you're speaking about is 90%. Those are the reasons.
Assaulted, Daniil.
You feel assaulted.
Assaulted. How about you?
I feel frustrated. I don't feel assaulted.
This is a great, it's a great moment of defining our emotional nuances here.
But I make a distinction between those who are calling for a ceasefire because they belittle October 7th and they belittle the legitimacy or deny the legitimacy of our right to not have Hamas threaten our civilians. I believe we have a right to that. And those who are calling for a ceasefire because they believe that we're not going to be able to achieve our goals.
That's an important distinction.
Like the distinct, like you mentioned a line, you cannot psychologically live with the fact that Hamas will be able to declare victory. I think even if Hamas is destroyed, they're going to be able to declare victory. Their, our ability to control what they declare, I think you want them to say uncle. And I think
no, I want, first of all, the region
fair
to
enough.
Understand.
So that, let's change that. So therefore, that's a more subtle notion, that the point that you have raised numerous times over the last 81 days is the need to reclaim the deterrence of Israel's military power. That's different than Hamas being able to declare victory.
Mm-hmm.
Because I believe,
fair enough.
Because I believe actually already now, given what we've achieved in Gaza, Israel's military strength is clear.
Say more about that.
Look what we did. The army has operated on a level of sophistication, skill. It's just remarkable when you look at what we have achieved. Now, it's a beyond our pay grade.
No, but I think it's an important point you're raising that on October 8th, many Israelis had a strong question mark over whether the army is still capable of defending us. And I think you're right, that question mark has been removed.
And I think, again, because I speak very often with people from Iran and Hezbollah.
Your inside sources.
My inside sources, yes. I think it's self-evident. The fact that Israel has a powerful, skilled military is clear. I think there is challenges of achieving certain goals in Gaza, given what Gaza is, that within 3 months, it was unreasonable to expect. And the nature of Gaza as a 400-kilometer military installation underneath civilian targets and a civilian population presents, besides a moral challenge, which is unprecedented in war, as I said the last time, it also presents unprecedented military challenges. And so I think our deterrence has been reclaimed. But when somebody says, listen, you achieved as much as you're going to achieve, like take the Tom Friedman article, you achieved as much as you're going to achieve. Tom Friedman, in his article, speaks about the fact that it's time to declare, on Israel's side, a unilateral ceasefire. Withdraw. If we fight for another month, so you'll get another couple of allies. You're not going to substantively change, and you're not going to be able to destroy all of Hamas in another month, maybe 8-10 months, but you don't have the ability to continue. That's the presumption. And he feels that the best victory that we would have is turn it over to Hamas and say, okay, Gaza's now yours again. And the first day, they're going to come out with great declarations of victory. That's why I responded to your to your initial condition. They're going to come up, we won, and it's true. They're still going to have their 20,000 soldiers, and they're still going to be able to show pictures of their tunnels. And so that's going to be the first day. And then Tom Friedman says, don't worry about the first day. I know the first day is going to be hard for you. That's what he's implying. But the second day, he says, the second day is when the population's going to rebel against Hamas like they did against Hezbollah in Lebanon. That was his argument.
And what do you think of it?
See, there's two stages to it. The first is that it's very different than when somebody says, have a ceasefire because your war was illegitimate. I'm still frustrated by it. I'm still frustrated, but the one thing that I think we have to begin to think about, and I want to expand on this together, is do we have any other scenario of an end of war that we could be comfortable with other than the Netanyahu and national proclamation, Hamas is going to be wiped off the face of the earth. So when I say I'm frustrated, I don't feel assaulted, it's because I feel challenged.
When I read Tom Friedman's latest, I appreciated it. It looked really good on paper. But I think the fatal flaw in his argument is that Hamas is going to stew in the ruins. Those ruins will be rebuilt. The UN will step in. Iran will step in. Qatar. Hamas is not going to be left to its own self-destruction. So that's one issue that I have. In terms of what I would consider to be a reasonable approximation of victory, because that's really what we're talking about, would be, first of all, Hamas is not going to be wiped off the face of the earth. That's something we all know. Hamas will continue one form or another. But for me, the model is Beirut 1982, when Arafat and the senior leadership of the PLO were forced by the IDF to leave for Tunis, go into exile. Let the Hamas leadership go to Qatar, let them go to Turkey, and let the PA and an international force come in, and let's begin the reconstruction of Gaza. That, for me, is a scenario that I can live with.
I could live with that one, too, but part of what I'm worried about is that we're not going to get that one. And when I hear the discussion of ceasefire, it challenges me to start to have to make accommodations. And that's where I get frustrated. Because I want to win. Not only do I want to, I deserve to. I morally deserve to. And part of the frustration of our neighborhood is that so often we have rights to things that we're not able to achieve and we're not able to attain. And that gap is a very frustrating gap. Like, I want my kids to be safe. I don't want my kids to have to go to the army. You know, I want to be Scandinavia. Why not? Why shouldn't I be Scandinavia without the suicide rates? Like, I want it. But part of what these last 81 days has really brought home very deeply to me is the gap between what I have a right to and what I have to learn how to adjust to. And maybe that was the first 50 years of Israel where we took that for granted, that there was going to be a gap. And I think the last 20 years, we sort of denied that there was a gap and we pretended that we didn't have it. And so I want what you want. I would love to see Sinwar and Def and all of them have to get on a boat or go into Egypt and have to fly and let them declare whatever victory it is. And then they have to be in Qatar and they have all their billions that they already stole and they could fly around the world with their planes. And then one day the Mossad will get them. That's a happy ending I can live with. But what happens if I don't get that? What happens if Hamas, some of its army is still going to be there? And I look at the Egyptian plan. And I'm challenged by it because I'm not ready to say amen to it, but it haunts me because I'm wondering whether that's all I'm going to get. The Egyptian plan says that there should be a ceasefire now and we should start prisoner exchange and that Gaza should be turned over to international force and that the political life of Gaza should be run by a group of technocrats from the Palestinian Authority and Hamas. Now, could I weave a narrative that Hamas technocrats are not the same? It's not what I want. I'm with you. I like your adjustment because you already did the adjustment. I don't have to kill all of them. I don't have to achieve that. We just have to get them to say uncle, to give in, to surrender, and to leave. This conversation is challenging to me. Could I live with that? And if I don't live with that, what are the consequences of what's going to happen for another 80 days of war on Israeli society and Gazan society? And will there be a substantive change in the next 80 days? And if it won't be, at what point does a just war, if you can't achieve its goals, and there are dire consequences, begin to be, its legitimacy gets undermined?
So I have a different question, an urgent question, and I don't know how to measure the answer. But the question is, how do we ensure, reasonably ensure, that the evacuees, close to 200,000 people from the southern border and the northern border, will feel reasonably safe to go home again? And if we can't provide an answer at the end of this war that will be in some way acceptable, and again, we're not looking at the ideal here, for people to say, you know what, okay, I'm going to try again to raise families on Israel's borders, on the border of Iran's surrogates. That for me is the measure of what I'm looking to achieve. And again, I don't know how to measure it. But think about it, Daniil. Think about the morning after, if we have tens of thousands of Israelis saying, I'm not going back. Who won the war?
I couldn't agree with you more, but that's where I'm frustrated. Yossi, we're sitting in a studio. I'm wearing a gun. I'm wearing a gun. I walk around with a gun all the time. I'm worried about something going on in Baca. I'm not wearing it to protect myself against some Israeli dictatorship. I'm wearing it because there are people who want to kill me, and I'm aware of it, and I don't want to be a victim. So, Yossi, what security do I have? What do I have? What are the hundreds of thousands of Israelis who are now getting gun permits? What are they saying? They're saying that Kfar Aza and Be'eri is unique, but it could be in Jerusalem, it could be in Tel Aviv, it could be anywhere. It could be anywhere. And I so much identify with what you're saying. But maybe a perpetual war to achieve that which we have a right to is just not going to be achieved. Now, it scares me because we went to war with a clear understanding of what is our moral right. Now, I don't know how the people of the Gazan envelope go home. I don't know how they go home. I know that Israelis have a remarkable spirit, and they're going to go home. And I know that we as a country are going to try to build there the most beautiful things. We're going to try to compensate for our failure. And I don't think Shderot is going to be left alone. And I think we're going to try to say, this is the Zionist victory. But at the end, the Zionist victory is about rebuilding. I don't think we're always going to get the Zionist victory of security that we have a right to. Certainly not on the northern border.
Look, I appreciate that. My view from my neighborhood, French Hill, which sits literally next to a Palestinian village, which is more like a town, Isawiya, which is on our side of the security barrier, is that after October 7th, we started locking our door. And we used to be pretty relaxed about it. And we live ground floor, opening up to a public space. And now that door is always locked. And we have nightmares, and this is true for my neighbors as well in French Hill, of large mobs of rioters coming over from Isawiya. They don't have to cross any border. It's literally 100 meters away. And would we be defenseless? So October 7th changed the psychological orientation of everyone here to the question of personal safety. But still, there are gradations. And I don't know if I would agree at this point to go back if I lived on the southern or northern borders. I don't know, Daniil. And when we talk about the northern border, Benny Gantz said this the other day, and I hope it wasn't just rhetoric, that by the end of this war, one way or the other, Hezbollah must go back to behind the Litani River, which is 40 kilometers from the Israeli border. Right now, they're sitting on the border, which we allowed to happen over the years. They violated one ceasefire agreement after the other. What that would mean, of course, is a war in the north. And you and I have discussed this before. And by extension, if I'm taking the logic of my argument to its final conclusion, this war cannot end without Hezbollah being forced back to the Litani. Now, are we ready for that? Can we fight that war? We've had that conversation. So
Can I challenge you just for a second on this?
Where it hits me emotionally.
I know, because look, when we talk about, I just want to observe, and I want you to respond to it, the conversation about ceasefire in Gaza is activating thoughts of a war in the north.
Yes, yes. And I think that that's a really good insight into the confusion in the Israeli psyche today. What do we mean? Does a ceasefire mean that Hezbollah remains on the border, that Hamas remains on the border? What are the parameters of the morning after a ceasefire?
I would wish for us to decomplexify it a little bit and to deal with one problem at a time. I think already now, on the South, we have a higher degree of security. And the security will be enhanced not necessarily by continuing to fight, but by the type of measures we institute and ensure. And none of them are going to be fail-safe. And there can always be a day where the troops, it's a holiday, and the troops are divided, and people hear about a danger and don't take it as seriously. And that, as I've said before many times, the capacity of human beings for error is infinite. And anybody who is looking for certainty, the only thing that's certain, what do they say, is death and taxes or whatever. You just, welcome to our world. But do I believe that Hamas has been seriously curtailed, especially in the north? Do I believe their ability to function has been curtailed? Absolutely.
Especially in the north of Gaza.
In the north of Gaza. Thank you. And maybe that's enough. And we haven't even raised today the issue of the moral consequences of continuing the fight. But I think it's part of the conversation, and maybe we have to talk about it. We've spoken and talked at another time. But part of the question of when we accept a ceasefire has to do with how much more we could achieve with another month, 2 months. Will that strategically change? At least according to the Israeli military, it won't. The commanders in the field are saying, we need 8 months, a year, 2 years. And they look at Mosul and they say, what America had to deal with there is nothing compared to what we have to do. Gaza is a unique military challenge. Not, you know, for a superpower, you know, if we wanted a level, but that's not what here. The house to house, 80% of the houses are booby trapped. Just the enormity. We need another year, 2 years. So let's say, Yossi, we take 2 months. 3 months. The humanitarian crisis is just going to increase. The calls for ceasefire are going to grow. The moral justification of October 7th is going to fade. It's going to fade.
Oh, it already has for people.
Outside
of
Israel. And then you ask, so what is it that you need to do? Like one of our colleagues said to us that one of the challenges of a just war is people being able to see that you have clear and achievable goals. And that's why you're continuing to fight. That's a version of the famous proportionality argument in morality of war. The proportionality says that when you engage in a certain operation, that you take into account the expected consequences and the expected benefits to the best of your ability. And if we do that over the next month or two, what are they? And I'm very frustrated by it. You know what? I'm angry by it because I want Hamas, not Gazans. I want Hamas terrorists dead. It's simple. I want them dead. I want them on a boat going to Qatar, going to anywhere in the world. But what do we do if we don't get that, Yossi?
I'm not ready yet to ask that question, which brings us full circle back to our original question. Where is this hitting you? And I think it was, for me, a very revealing moment when you were asking about, okay, the ceasefire in Gaza, and I took it to Hezbollah. And I think that what that tells us about where we're at is that for Israelis, this is not just the Israeli-Hamas war.
Correct. Absolutely
and
correct,
people
Jesse.
Abroad need to understand that.
It's not Gaza.
It's not Gaza. It's the Shiite arc. It's Iran. And so Hamas staying in power has implications, repercussions, far beyond the Gaza border. That's where, in the end, I'm left without.
That's very important. I don't think it's repercussions or implications. You're really fighting a different war. It's not Hamas. You are fighting all of us. We are fighting a war for our right to be safe.
Our right to be here.
To be here. And for our families not to be exposed to this evil. And so it happens to be that right now the front is Hamas.
Exactly.
The front is Gaza. But this is not Gaza. Now, I appreciate that. I do. And I don't know what to do with it. I really don't. And how does Israel realistically assess its abilities, its power? And power has to do with the strength of your society. There, our society, our alliance. It's remarkable, the amount of bravery and commitment. That is our greatest strength. But at the end, you also need weapons and you need bombs. And we need someone to provide them for us. And we have an economy because we don't want to live like Syria. We want to live like Scandinavia. And also, military might is connected to your position in the world. And I think all of those have to lead us not to caution, but to how frustrated can we be? Like, I'm seeing your body right now, and you're frustrated. But maybe
I'm contorted.
I'm frustrated, and I hear you. But maybe that's the challenge of Zionism, is within that, we don't get everything. And so when people speak about ceasefire, I feel that part of them don't morally understand our rights and don't embrace our rights.
And don't understand our dilemmas.
And don't understand our dilemmas and don't understand our frustration. And at the same time, as is always the case, sometimes you need someone from the outside to activate a conversation that inside you don't know how to start. Our politicians don't know how to start it. Nobody's talking honestly. Nobody's speaking seriously. This is the day after. It's not the day after the war ends. The day after is tomorrow. How do you talk about tomorrow? How do you help us readjust? It's going to be emotionally and intellectually very challenging.
A roller coaster.
It's a roller coaster. This is For Heaven's Sake, Israel at War, Day 81.
Phew, huh? The reason it came to me why I share these podcasts with you is because I feel inarticulate, and in my ability to explain a position that I have no idea what it is, except for what those guys say, you know what they said. So a couple of things. First of all, it would help to have been familiar with Tom Friedman's article. They alluded to Tom Friedman's article a number of times and based the whole early part of their conversation on that. Is anybody not familiar with that article? Because I can rap it up Okay, so the crux of the article they actually spoke to, that Tom Friedman's making the case for ceasefire, and that on the first day and the second day, you know, Hamas can say whatever they want to say about winning, but after that, the leadership of Hamas is going to come out of their hiding places, and the people are going to basically hold them to the fire for destroying their houses and destroying their whole civilization. Restructuring can happen from there, but then they make the point, of course, that Hamas is not going, will eventually, you know, rebuild and do what they, or try to do anyway, what they, it's in their charter, that's what they say to say, they will do. And so that was basically the crux of the Tom Friedman article. So with that, I was curious if any of you have any reflections, and I want to invite you to do so in this way. their latest podcast has actually to do, that I listened to this morning, has to do with the judicial reform, which we dealt with several months ago here on a Wednesday night. And the fact that the Supreme Court basically has just, in a double negative, said that, well, you can't do what you can't put the judicial reform in, and so it seems it's hard to say. So they cannot not override the Knesset cannot not override the Supreme Court for, and the reasonableness clause is now out the window for now anyway. So they're talking about that, and I probably did not articulate it the best ways, but that's why I leave it to those guys. In any case, what they do get into is the civil discourse that's necessary in order to have hard conversations, such as over the judicial reform and anything in any, you know, democratic society, which just hit home for me, because we certainly have lost that ability to have that as well. They point out that those kinds of dialogues are seen and understood as a conversation, Malach HaShemayim, right? So it's a conversation for the sake of heaven, right? So what's the example of a conversation for the sake of heaven? It says in Pirkei Avot, one between Beit Hillel and Beit Shammai. I think we did a class on this some time ago. Why is it that? Because even though they had heavy disagreements of those two schools of thought, their children married each other, they ate at each other's houses. In the end, when they walked out of the Beit Midrash, you know, where they were studying, and when they came to blows over these kinds of things, there was unity afterwards, and understanding that, hey, you know, we're all in this together. Now, they kind of, in their conversation, it's a really interesting one, they kind of put a whammy on that, in that, like, what unity? We've kind of, in our Jewish world, we have broken up into sects, S-E-C-T-S. Each of us has our own Rebbe, and whatever the Rebbe says, you know, we follow our Rebbe's way of halacha, of walking in the world. So let's not put a show about us all being one happy family, because that's not true. But what is true is that we need to get back to the point where we can disagree with each other, but not want to kill each other. And we can disagree with each other on points that, okay, I get your point. You know, we just differ on this, right? But as we are faced in this country, you know, we are split in a binary way between, and I think that I can speak for most, if not all of us here, in that our disagreements are not for the sake of heaven, but for rather destroying the other and for demonizing the other. So that's a long way of saying, in the way I'd like to invite you to offer reflection in two ways. Number one, if you'd like to ask a question that has no answer, in other words, what I'm wondering about is the following, and then just let it lie. And, you know, some of us will go internally, will say me too. Or the other thing is, if you want to offer how you're feeling at this moment, so no, the way I like to protect this space is by not entering into political discourse that's going to necessarily not be a dialogue that happens in social media where people are yelling and screaming at each other, but one in which we hear each other respectfully, even if we are not totally aligned with each other's what we say and what we're feeling. So, whew, all of that. I don't think I took a breath during that unending sentence. That was the longest pasuk in all of Torah. Devorah Lesk, what you got?
Well, I think what I'm reading more and more the last few days is this distinction between Jews in Israel and the diaspora, and what each of those two is, and that's like Shammai and Hillel in a sense. Like those who live there have a different perspective from those of us who don't live there. And then the third factor is the rest of the world and how they are seeing what's going on in Israel. So it's even become more complex now that there's been that distinction. So
Thanks for pointing that out. Absolutely. Hold on a second. I need to make my camera return to where it was. yes, it's not just between Israel and the rest of the world, but Israel and diaspora Jews. All complex, so complex. Anybody else? Any thing about what you heard, in the podcast? Also, you can offer a reflection on or a question, Ellen.
Podcasts are amazing.
Oh, your audio is unlistenable. You're kind of a cross between Jacques Cousteau and the Chipmunks. Was that good? Devorah, you like that? Go ahead, try again, Ellen.
Okay.
Oh, no.
Okay, no. Never mind it.
Okay, put it in the chat if you if there's something that, I'm sorry. I'm not sure what's going on. We can't troubleshoot it right now. Anyone else?
I have something.
Please, Brian.
I appreciated that. I think they certainly hit the nail on the head, and that is Iran is behind this. So it seems to me that how can Israel do enough to convince Iran that Israel won? I think that's, to me, the big question. And the other part is that October 7th unleashed all this, incredible anti-Semitism. I don't know how that's ever going to be tamed.
Yeah. Or put another way, how do you push the genie back into the bottle?
Yeah, exactly.
I'm not sure when this began or re-began, but certainly Charlottesville comes to mind. So just leave it at that. But Brian, it's like so complex to the point where, I'm not sure I would walk out without a baseball cap on anymore. There are times where I go out with my kippah. I started wearing my kippah many years ago, right before I got smicha in 2012. Holy cow, 12 years ago. Whew, time flies. And I don't think I would do that anymore right now.
How does it make you feel?
Vulnerable.
Sad.
Well, very sad for sure. Yeah. Sad not just for myself, but for the world, for the culture that we find ourselves in, and of course the ugly re-rising of anti-Semitism, which is a lot older than any of us here, all right, predates all of us in many ways. As a matter of fact, let that be a coming attraction to a Wednesday night. I'm not sure when, but I'm going to share a movie with you someday soon called, so The Ice of History. I forget the title of it, but it's a documentary on Oneg Shabbat, which is one of the reasons why we are called Minyan Oneg Shabbat, which was a group of people who in the Warsaw Ghetto who saved all the artifacts and placed them in milk containers and metal boxes and buried them. And most of that those artifacts were discovered after the war. They were dug up because they left maps. And amidst the destruction of the Warsaw Ghetto and wartime following, they were able to dig those up. And so I'm going to share that with you at some point. But let's get back to this conversation. Anyone else? Please, Rachel. I can unmute you.
Thank you.
Go ahead. You're unmuted.
I speak to my family every day, sometimes twice a day. And they're all in Tel Aviv, Herzliya, Ramat Gan, Ra'anana. They're all there. And they truly believe that if the United States government will tell the Israelis, get out and stop, they will stop. They will not do anything without the American approval. They will not, they just can't. They can't do it because they cannot afford to do it. They won't get money, they won't get weapon, they won't get anything. So this is a part that nobody talk about, but this is, you know, this is known from the beginning that the president says it's terrible. Yeah, let's go and do it. And they did. And they did not hear from him or from his government enough. You know, they heard, just don't hurt the kid. And don't, but when you throw a bomb, you're going to hurt the kid. I mean, the kids are there. They put them there. So this is one thing. The other thing is that I really feel that so many opinion in the diaspora, opinions of Jews are really not unacceptable, because I don't think if you're not there and your kids are not, is not killed there, and you cannot come and say you are bad and you're doing bad things. Because they did get, I mean, from the beginning, they got bad things from them. And there is no, I don't know how is it going to, it will never finish. It will never be done. My parents are from Syria. I was born in Syria. We came to the country, to Israel, when I was 2 years old. My three brothers were in the army. We lost one. One was hurt in his head. And my father always said, there will never, ever, ever be peace with the Muslims. It won't happen. It just won't happen. And they truly believe in it. Now there's nobody, no Jews in Syria, zero in Syria. Not one single one. And they're, you know, and they're, and the Palestinians that are in Israel are very happy there. And they tell you that they're very happy. For heaven's sake, the president of Bank Leumi, which is the Israeli bank, is an Arab, is a Palestinian, he's an Arab. So they can't tell them, they really are very, very, they're almost better than the Zionists for the Jews. They say, we love Israel. We like. So I think that we get a lot of bad talk from, you know, from the American Jews. It's not from all from Europe. Europe are more, you know, more for the what happening now for Israel. But from here I'd already started to hear, you know, well, why don't you take your mezuzah down? I said, I'm not gonna take my mezuzah down. I won't do it. I'm Israeli. I serve in the Israeli Air Force. I will not do that. So, I mean, it's not a kippah. A kippah is a different thing. The kippah is more, you know, everybody can see. But here, when somebody come to my house, they can see that, well, if you want to come, that's fine. If not, go away. But I am really, really sad. I'm so sad. I'm really sad because it's it happened. Everybody thinks that they, oh, we suddenly know that we have anti-Semitism in the United. Of course we do. We always did, you know. But it wasn't in the open. Now it's more in the open, and yeah. And I don't know how it's gonna stop. I really don't. So it's very frustrating, very sad.
Thank you, Rachel. I want to share, I wasn't planning on doing this, but because of your comment, Brian, and also some things that you mentioned, Rachel, my friend Rabbi Mark Biller posted something in a Facebook post after he'd had enough. and he says at the beginning of the post, he's had enough with people be calling Israel an apartheid state. And he says, here's my answer once, and I'm going to say it once, and then I'm not going to be participating in any of these conversations anymore. And I want to share this with you because it touches upon some of the things, again, that Brian and Rachel, you were just touching upon. And so I'll just read it without any more comment. Here's what he says. For centuries, Jews were subject to blood libel. The propaganda that Jews killed Christian children to use their blood to make matzah on Passover. It was sworn to as fact by people who were sure they knew it to be true. Even though Jews are not even allowed to eat blood and are trained in kindness for the minute we are born. The modern blood libel is that Jews have created an apartheid state. And people who do not know will swear it is true, just as they swore that Jews killed babies for their blood in the Middle Ages, in the 1800s and 1900s, and even the 20th century. Anyone who's been to Israel or studied the facts on the ground, all caps, would know that the notion of Israel being an apartheid state is complete nonsense. There are facts. There are Arab policemen in Israel. There are Arab doctors and nurses in Israel. As a matter of fact, I believe it is a plurality of doctors and nurses that are Arab. There are Arab members of the Israeli parliament. There are Arab members of the Israeli Defense Force. These are facts. Almost one third of Israeli citizens are not Jews. They have full legal rights under the law. Israel is the only country in the Middle East that guarantees freedom of religion and guarantees freedom of access to religious sites to all groups. Israeli hospitals treat Arab, Jewish, Christian citizens equally. Not only that, Israel forces pick up civilians who can't get the medical aid they need in the surrounding Arab countries. And so they walk along the Israeli border, hoping to be picked up and brought to Israeli hospitals where they are treated for free and then get taken back to where they can get back to their own houses in their home countries. By the way, I may have mentioned our friend Fern Reese at the prayerful gatherings, who's basically saying that we can't even do that anymore because it's too dangerous. Mm-hmm. While we're at it, over the decades, over 800,000 Jews have been expelled from surrounding Arab countries, Rachel, right? Countries where they're not allowed to live, but not allowed to visit. It sounds like ethnic cleansing of Jews from those countries to me. Again, a third of Israeli citizens are not Jews. They have equal rights. The Israeli parliament is Arab members of parliament, so on and so forth. These are the facts. So facts, though, don't fit into a narrative of the bad Jews. It's, when I read that, I thought, well, tell me how you really feel about it, Mark. I was very, very moved by his passion and gathering all of that up. But as we know, social media, you really can't make points. You can only make enemies. So it's about 25 past the hour. And I want to share with you a poem. And then I was hoping to have time for another short oral quick piece from a different podcast. But I really want to share this poem with you. I'm going to put it on the screen. The poem is called The Silver Platter. In Hebrew, it's called Magash HaKesef, or as you pointed out to me before, Rachel, the silver tray. This poem was written by the renowned Hebrew poet Nathan Alterman. Please know as you listen to it that this poem was published in a Hebrew newspaper in 1947, before the establishment of Israel, and was not about the fallen in Israel's wars, but a prediction of the deaths that would occur in upcoming wars for freedom and the state of Israel. How prescient this poem was. You see a photo of Nathan Alterman on the right, and so much is he renowned that they put him on the face of the 200 shekel bill. Here's his poem. So the land grows still. Red fades in the sky over smoking frontiers in Israel. Heartsick but breathing, the people greet the wonder that has no parallel. Beneath the moon, they stand and wait, facing the dawn in awe and joy. Then slowly, towards the waiting throng, two step forth, a girl and a boy, clad for work and for war, heavy shod and still. Up the winding path, they make their way, their clothes unchanged, still soiled with the grime of the battle-filled night and the toilsome day. Weary past telling, strangers to sleep, but wearing their youth like dew in their hair. Dumb they approach. Are they living or dead? Who knows? As they stand unmoving there, tear-stained, wondering, the people ask, "Who are you?" And softly reply the two, "We are the silver platter on which the Jewish state is handed to you." In shadow they fall when their tale is untold. The rest let Israel's story unfold. I know besides Rachel, any of you familiar with that poem? It paints a picture of today and all the other wars that we've been in, which seems like almost constantly since fill in the blank. You know me, I like to end things on a note of hope. So no matter how gray, dark, the Haftarah might be on a particular Shabbos morning, you know, it always ends with a note of hope and end. It never ends, you know, with the destruction of the temple, you know, on our thoughts. You know, Hashiveinu Adonai Elech v'nashuva, you know, it'll end there, you know, return to us, cause us to return to you and we will return, and so on and so forth. So I do want to share this other podcast with you. And And this podcast is a podcast called The Promised. It's one of my go-to podcasts. It's hosted by three different people. One is Don Futterman, and he's been host of TLV1's The Promised podcast for 11 years. And this was his segment. It's a weekly review of politics and society in Israel. He grew up in Flushing, New York. He's lived in Boston, San Francisco, Seattle, and Providence, and has lived in Israel since 1994. As a matter of fact, all three of the hosts of the Promise podcast grew up in the United States. And so when you listen to it, there's no affect, they have no accent. What Don is going to be telling us about is the memorial service for Vivian Silver, 74 years old, Canadian-Israeli peace activist, who was thought to possibly have been kidnapped on October 7th, but later found that she was murdered. She was a woman of infinite, deep, ongoing compassion, humanity, and dedicated to Arab-Jewish partnership and peace, which makes her killing that much more You fill in the blank for that too. So I'm going to pull this up. I think it's a little less than 10 minutes long. And then we'll come back. And like I said, this is a note. A note of silver lining, is that the right expression? Just a note of hope, because what a strong, strong worker she was for peace and what she brought to that process. Here we go. Let me just make sure I'm set up in the way I need to be set up. Yeah, okay.
Be part of the Sudat Mitzvah, bringing together all these people, Chilonim, Dati'im, Asortim, and Haredim, bringing together the connections and the sense of solidarity we were talking about earlier. Tuesday night, I went to the memorial program for Vivian Silver, Zichrona Livracha. I won't talk much about Vivian because Noah gave a remarkable eulogy on this podcast in mid-November when it was discovered that she had been killed on October 7th and not taken into captivity as had been thought. And if you haven't heard it, I recommend you go back and listen. The memorial program was a place of communion for peace activists and Jews and Bedouin, reconnecting, listening to talks in Hebrew and Arabic and one in English about Vivian, which felt natural to relieve for a few hours the loneliness of absence. And unlike the case in so many other settings in Israel these days, no one was troubled to hear Arabic. No one was troubled to hear Hebrew, because the folks in this room have long-standing and profound connections to one another. Every speaker insisted that peace is still possible, that we are not doomed to live by the sword for eternity. Vivian's son, Yonatan, described his mother's death as the starting shot in the race to peace. And Kher Elbaz from Ajik, the Bedouin empowerment organization Vivian helped found, quoted her declaring, "Hashalom hu haderech, velo haderech l'shalom." Roughly, it's not that we're on the way to peace, but that peace is the way. Before the formal program, someone told me how happy she thought Vivian would be to see everyone together. So these words can be grouped as one: peace, equality, hope, community. As long as we stay connected, we are not alone.
Hear, hear, Alice.
As always, I couldn't have said it any better. As long as we stay connected, we are not alone. As long as we seek justice, tzedek tzedek tirdof, we are not alone. And as long as we cling to bayom hahu yehyeh Adonai echad u'shemo echad, on that day, we're not alone. So as always, I thank you for joining me and holding each other in this sacred space. Even though it's not, there's no matbea to the service as it would if we were opening a sidur, I still feel like, we're holding each other and we're being held and finding meaning together. And there is a holiness to these gatherings that just remind me that there is no beginning and there is no end. And God willing, we'll find a way out of this morass as well. I couldn't think of a better way to end tonight with, but Kululam one day. And so this is the message that we all need to sing, and has been proposed that this be the national anthem of the entire world. I think you'll agree with me. Okay, I think I know what's going on. I think I need to stop that. That buildup to it was so good, too. I thought the lead-in went really nicely. Maybe I'll have to repeat everything I just said. Okay, you can just play it back when you listen to it again. No, I don't want that. I'm still screen sharing. That's the problem. Okay. Yeah, all righty. Bayom hahu, my sweet friends. Two, but it's, I don't know what's causing this. Any ideas, Devorah?
What's the problem? We're seeing it.
Are you hearing it though?
We're hearing it and we're seeing it.
Oh, you're hearing it. Excellent. Okay, it's just on my end. Okay, three times the charm. Sometimes in my tears I drown, but I never let it get me down. So when negativity surrounds, I know someday it'll all turn around. Because all my life I've been waiting for, I've been praying for the people to say that we don't want to fight no more, there'll be no more war, and the children will play one day, one day. One day, one day, one day, one day, one day, one day. V'nehemar v'haya Adonai l'melech kol ha'aretz b'yom ha'hu yihyeh Adonai echad u'shemo echad. One day, One day, may it be today. Laila Tov, everyone. Thank you so, so much. I mean, we amen, huh? Yom Echad, one day, may it be today.